A fountain. He will hold me fast for my sake. Well, welcome to our service today. My name is Steve Rees. I'm the vicar of All Saints Church here in Crowborough. As you can see, I'm back inside part of the building, and we've been given permission to come back in and pray as vicars into our churches and also to record services from this place. So hopefully you'll be seeing more of the building over the coming weeks as we edge out of lockdown. I do believe it's going to be a long, long time before we can gather together on a Sunday. So we praise God for technology, that we can meet remotely at our homes via TV screens or laptops, and be encouraged to keep following Jesus and to share Jesus with our community and our world. Maybe you're joining us for the first time and you've been joining us and you've not been along to our church and you'd like to find out more. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to build that relationship during this time. So do be in touch with me via our website and send me an email, and I'll be delighted to make contact and let you know more about our vision and values here at All Saints Church in Crowborough. Well, this week we meet for a variety of meetings during the week, 24/7, 2:42. Our youth groups on Tuesday night via Zoom, with a talk being broadcast before that on the YouTube channel, our All Saints YouTube channel. Wednesday night is Women's Book Group. Thursday is Ascension Day, and to mark that, we're going to have a special reflection written about the ascension of our Lord Jesus. He reigns in glory now, and we remember that glorious day when he was taken to the right hand of the Father, and he sat down, a picture of his finished work for us in his life, and the way he's made for us to know God forever through his sacrifice for us on the cross and his resurrection. Thursday is Ascension Day. Friday night, we have our Thirsty Congregation via our YouTube website or via our website. And if you go there, you'll be able to click in and enjoy a service, 8 o'clock, of worship and prayer. Paul Feasy will be preaching in the series On Your Mind, thinking about body image. It'll be very useful to get along to that and to think through those issues of how God sees us, and to be taught by God's word during that service. Then next Sunday, we continue our series in Hebrews in the morning, 9:15, 10:45, 11 o'clock at St. Richard's, and then at 6:30, our series in 1 Samuel. Well, I hope you're doing well and hope you're keeping safe. And do let us know if we can help you or pray for you in any way. The Lord bless you, and may you be encouraged today through this service. God bless.
Hello and welcome to our evening service here at All Saints Church. It's great to have you with us today, wherever you are joining us from. My name is Sarah Thrift. I'm the Minister for Children and the Minister for Accessibility here at All Saints Church. We're going to start by singing a great song which reminds us of some of the attributes of God, that is who God is. He is holy, immortal, invisible, God only, wise, glorious, almighty. He is a God worth praising. So join with us now as we praise our God together from our sofas.
Majesty, awesome God, Most High, see him.
sang about a God who is inaccessible, holy, clothed in light and veiled from our eyes. God is so holy that rightfully we should not be able to approach him because of our sin. But because of Christ, who reveals God to us and makes the way for us to be right with him, we can approach God's throne and speak with him directly, because Jesus has wiped away our sin and given us his righteousness and holiness. So we're going to come to God now and confess the sins which come between us, and we can know for sure that when we do, in Christ, we are forgiven and made new. So let's confess our sins together now. God shows his love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us. Deliver us from judgment. Bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're going to sing together again now, another song which reminds us of God's great holiness and our need for rescue in Jesus, so that we can call this holy God our Father. Join with us as we sing Only a Holy God.
Who else commands all the hosts of heaven? Who else can make every king bow down? Who else could whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What are the beauty commands such praises? What are the splendor outshines the sun? What are the majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. What are the glory consumes like fire? What are the power can raise the dead? What are the name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy. Invites me to call him Father. Only a holy God, only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the
have our reading now from Janet, and then Mark is going to help us understand God's word as he explains it to us in the sermon. So let me pray as we prepare to hear from God. Father God, thank you so much that you speak to us through your word, the Bible. Please help us to listen well, to understand it, and to be changed by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
The reading today is taken from 1 Samuel chapter 1 verses 4 to 20. That's 1 Samuel chapter 1 starting at verse 4. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her and the Lord had closed her womb. Because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival would provoke her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Her husband Elkanah would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? Once, when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house. In her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly. And she made her vow, saying, "Lord Almighty, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." As she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk and said to her, "How long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine." "Not so, my lord," Hannah replied. "I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I have been praying here out of my great anguish and grief." Eli answered, "Go in peace, and may the Lord God of Israel grant you what you have asked for him." She said, "May your servant find favour in your eyes." Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Early the next morning, they rose and worshipped before the Lord, and then went back to their home at Ramah. Elkanah made love to his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. So in the course of time, Hannah became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, saying, "Because I asked the Lord for him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, our story is set miles from here. We're in a place 20 miles north of Jerusalem, but of course Jerusalem didn't exist in that time. It was a place called Shiloh. And the people of God would gather, those tribes would gather on each of the hillsides around this place. It was the tent of meeting, and in it, the priest and the Ark of the Covenant. It was a place where God's people gathered to worship him. It's an amazing sight. And even to this day, there's an archaeological dig going on. I visited it 2 years ago. Well, the context of the story, though, was that this is after the judges. The judges had come and gone, and we're going to find also that the last judge is going to be Samuel. But the story of the judges was not an encouraging one. God's people were in a worse state. In fact, they had deteriorated time and time again in judges. As the judges were raised up and the judges then died, God's people rebelled. The end of Judges 21:25 says, "In those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as they saw fit." It was anarchy. People basically lived how they wanted to.
Even the priesthood was corrupted. Hophnius and Phinehas, we're going to see. Hophni and Phinehas, we're going to read about in chapter 2. Eli's sons were corrupt. God's people admittedly were in God's place, the promised land, but they were not seeing life and the blessing of God because they continued to be rebellious and sinful. And as we will see from Hannah's prayer in a short while, God opposes the proud and exalts the humble, even if it is God's people who are the ones that need to be humbled. God has a plan, and even though it may appear impossible to us, God is the God of the possible. Have you ever wondered why in the Bible God takes the most unlikely and impossible scenarios and unlikely people to achieve his purposes? On several occasions, this revolves around couples who are unable to give birth. The Bible describes Hannah as having her womb closed by God. Being childless for many is a great source of pain and anguish. And I want to be careful to acknowledge the trauma and the suffering that many go through. Whilst not raising this as an example of how we are to get pregnant, and that actually the reason why you don't have a child is because you don't pray like Hannah prays. Now, this is not what we're to learn here. Generation have come and generation have gone, and people continue to pour out their hearts to God in the same way that Hannah did, crying to God for children, some crying to God for health, some crying to God for happiness. And none of these things are bad in and of themselves, but we must acknowledge that the answer from God sometimes is no. Even though we may want a good thing, he might have another plan. Well, Elkanah's wives were at odds with each other. The jealousy ran deep. One was barren, but the favourite, distraught and refusing to eat. The other, a mother many times over, we're told a little later on, but second. Let's read verse 5. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. And because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year after year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Her husband Elkanah would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons?" Well, of course, it wasn't an issue of love. But actually, sometimes our value and our worth, our purpose in life gets sewn up in what we can and can't do, whether we've got children and how many, how much we earn. Well, we need to guard our hearts at the beginning of this story because we are to be satisfied with God. Let us remember that as Hannah started at this surprising beginning of the story, that actually her earnestness and honesty before God answers her prayer. But that actually we are to be satisfied in him. And although it's right for us to long and seek for good things, we need to remember that actually he might have another plan for us. God's ways are not always our ways, but they are always good. He promises. Chapter 7, verse 11 of Matthew tells us, "If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him?" God is the good giver, is the great giver, and much better than we are at giving gifts. So what do we see as Hannah, this sincere heart? We get a model of a God, a fatherly God who cares. But we do need to be careful when we make vows. We see here in these desperate times, sometimes we turn to desperate measures and pray and make vows to God. If God, you do this, I'll do that. God, if you do this, I'll do that. Well, there's a wartime story about a gentleman called Louis Zamperini and his story. He was an Olympic runner and ended up being captured by the Japanese and was tortured. And in that time, he made a prayer to God that he would follow him if he helped him during that wartime. Well, God did bring him out, and he did then commit his life to God, bringing forgiveness and preaching. But that's not always the pattern that we see. It's not a healthy model for us to say to God, if you do this, I'll do that. Because actually, well, we saw in Judges chapter 11, not so long ago, just before Samuel, we saw Jephthah. And what did he do? He made a vow to the Lord. He says, if you give the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out of the door of my house to meet me when I return in triumph from the Ammonites will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. And of course, his daughter comes out to greet him as he comes back from battle. As they've been given victory. Now, what a stupid vow that was. So this is not an example of a model of how we barter with God. What are we supposed to learn from this then? Well, we are to be living sacrifices, offering sincere worship to the God who knows far better than we know how to bring about salvation and how to do good. Let me take you back to Romans chapter 12, a familiar passage. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Well, what are your prayers for your children, your grandchildren, your God children? What are the prayers for those in the church family, the young people? Well, are they in accordance and in line with this? It's easy for us to pray and feel sorry for Samuel, who is has his life handed over, as we will see, to the priesthood and to follow Eli. But what a great prayer for us to pray, that actually we give our children to God. No ifs or buts. No, if you win this battle and if you do that, God, or if you do another. Well, actually, what a wonderful prayer for us to pray, that actually we desire for our children to worship you, our Lord and King. It is our heart's desire that they live sacrificial lives, holy and pleasing to God, in true and proper worship, not conforming to the pattern of the world, but having their minds transformed and renewed, being able to test what is good, pleasing, and God's perfect will. Well, that is the picture of being a living sacrifice. And that is a healthy model for us to follow. Not a vow, not an if and a but, but actually saying to God, we offer ourselves as living sacrifices and our whole household for you to glorify yourself through them.
Well, verse 19, we're taken back the next morning, and we see very early the next morning, they arose and they worshipped before the Lord, and then they went back to their home at Ramah. Elkanah made love to his wife, Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. So Hannah became pregnant and gave birth to a son, and she named him Samuel, saying, "Because I asked for the Lord for him, God has provided." Samuel means heard by God. Well, as we continue in this letter, let's watch out for those instances where actually the humble heart is what God desires. That sincere heart that says to God, I want you to be glorified in my life, in my children's lives. And we'll see in the book of Samuel how actually the proud are humbled, how the insincere of heart are brought low. And actually even those who had a great start, Saul and David, were brought low towards the end of their lives. They ended their lives in pride and pain. Well, we want to finish with this cry. We need a better king. We need someone greater. And that's where we finish our story as Hannah then prays. When Samuel was weaned, Hannah took Samuel back to the tent of meeting and gave him over to the Lord, verse 28. We see in this concluding prayer her joy and grasp of who God is, his plans for salvation. Well, we see that Hannah expresses her joy in a holy God, who there is none like you, the Lord, the word being Yahweh, who was and is to come, pointing back to God's faithfulness to his people. There is no one besides you, Hannah acknowledges. There is no rock but our God. Hannah starts by acknowledging how great God is and all that he's done. She has grasped this Lord, Yahweh. But she knows what he's doing as well, if you spot that in the prayer. He's humbling the haughty and he's lifting up the oppressed and the lowly. Listen to what Hannah says. "My mouth boasts over my enemies, for I delight in your deliverance. For the Lord is a God who knows, and by him deeds are weighed. The Lord brings death and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and raises up. The Lord sends poverty and wealth. He humbles and he exalts. He raises the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes, and he makes them inherit a throne of honor. For the foundations of the earth are the Lord's. On them he has set the world." Can you see Hannah's grasp that God is the one who has been raising nations and defeating them? God has been the one who is sovereign and in charge of it all. He raises up the poor, takes care of the needy, and he humbles and brings down the haughty. Well, we're going to see that in Samuel a little later on. The likes of David and Saul, they may have been raised up as great potential, but we're also going to see them brought down low. God is doing a great work, for one day he is going to send his king, the humble servant king. And that's where the prayer finishes off. The salvation king is to come. Let me read to you verse 10. It says, "And he will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his anointed." A horn was a picture of strength. And this strong king was to be anointed. The anointing oil that you'd pour over a king. And we'll see that again a little later on in Samuel. But of course, we think of Samuel and David being anointed, but we need to look a little further, for we will see Jesus in these pages. Jesus is in the background. His name is whispered. The Messiah will come. The faithful Yahweh God is to bring about his salvation for his people. God's people, God's place, and God's blessing. Well, they are in the place, Israel. They are his people set apart, and his blessing will fall when it is fulfilled in Jesus. This surprising start that we've seen. Just a good reminder that God knows our anguish and our circumstances. He knows our pain and the mess that we are in. He knows about your circumstances and the battles that you're facing. Maybe it's with loneliness. Maybe it's with illness. Maybe it's just this isolation, and maybe it's a business and financial crisis. God knows your circumstances. Be comforted. And know that God can help you in whatever impossible situation you might think that you're in. Secondly, the right response is a sincere heart. And we see that in Hannah. God is a God who cares, and he sees the humble and he raises them up. Well, that's what he's going to do to Hannah, and he's going to do time and time again through these books. So be on your guard. Remain humble and acknowledge the God who lifts you up. And lastly, see God's sovereign King in these pages. He's on his way. Be grateful and be ready to welcome him.
Thank you. Let us pray. In our reading tonight, we hear how Hannah prayed. She was desperate, so she prayed and prayed. She poured out her soul to God. When he understood her situation, the priest who was watching her said, "Go in peace, and may God grant you what you have asked of him." God our Father, we praise and thank you because you delight in hearing and answering our prayers. And we praise you because you care for us and love us so much that you sent your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross so that we might be saved and be at rest and peace with you. At this difficult time, help us all to remember your love and grace and the great cost it was to you to rescue us, and hold on to your peace in our hearts. Saviour God, we pray for your world at this time of pandemic. Please deliver us from this coronavirus and help us to return to a more normal life again. We thank you for all those people whose skills and commitment are tending the sick and providing for those in need. Please protect them as they face great risks themselves. We also pray for those who have lost loved ones and who have to deal with their loss in isolation. Please come close to them and comfort them and bring them a special peace at this time. We thank you for those who lead the world. Guide them, we pray, into wise and just decisions, especially as we hope for a lifting of the restrictions on our lives. May they always work for the benefit of all, especially the weak and the vulnerable. And we thank you and praise you for Elizabeth, our Queen, for her quiet and faithful leadership of this country. May we all follow her example of faith and trust in you. And finally, we thank you for being our provider who is able and loves to meet our needs. Please help us all at this time when there's so much uncertainty about the future. Help us to trust you more. And we pray particularly for our young people at this time, whose lives now seem to have been changed almost forever. Help them to deal with the stresses that the lockdown has brought, as they see the stresses their parents face and look on, perhaps not able to help themselves. We pray for their security and safety, and that they would grow in love and trust in the Lord Jesus. As the priest Eli said to Hannah, "May we go now in peace, and may God grant us what we have asked for." We pray all these things in the name of Jesus and for his glory. Amen.
Well, thank you for joining us this evening. Our service is coming to a close, but please do join us for Zoom coffee afterwards. It would be great to see you. If you're a regular member here, you will have received the login details already. We're going to end by singing a great song together, but first, let me pray. Father God, thank you so much that you know where each of us are. You know what our weeks will hold. Please be with us. Help us to live for you no matter what happens and to know your presence with us. Amen. Well, hopefully see you in a minute on the Zoom coffee chat. But if not, we'll see you soon. Have a good week. Bye.
let your song be heard everywhere on earth, till your sovereign work on earth is done. Let your kingdom come. Your strength, O God, and courage to speak. Perform your wondrous deeds through those who are weak. Lord, use us as you want, whatever the test. By grace we'll preach your gospel till our dying. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, so that everyone might know your name. Let your song be heard everywhere on earth, till your sovereign work on earth is done. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come.